respected panelists and the audience, I would like to thank IPPAI for giving me this opportunity. It is a pleasure, both a pleasure and a privilege to be here and sharing some of the insights on the subjects. They asked me to speak on smart water for smart cities. So, before going into the details of what are smart cities and how could we have smart water within these smart cities, let's first understand the unfolding urbanization in India. Now, urbanization in India could be characterized by the modest rates, but we are urbanizing with a very large population base, which is like almost 40 crores of people. Conventionally, there has been migration and natural growth, the main reasons for these, for urbanization, but now this is stabilizing. Now, in the recent 2001 and 11 census results, it has come out that horizontal expansion of cities on account of sprawl, on account of fringe development, and gradual change of land uses, converting of villages into urban areas, is a prime reason behind urbanization. Indian cities now contribute to 75% GDP and 70.3% of the national GHGs. And then they're also quite energy intensive, as in 85% of the thermal emissions in India are associated with cities. And if you see, in the last 10 odd years, the rate of urbanization has increased from 28% to 31%, and the next 20 more years or 25 years will almost be more urbanized than rural, as per the estimates. Now, what is the status of water supply and sanitation in Indian cities? 71% of urban Indian households have access to drinking water supply within their premises, which is bit improved from 2001, and 20.7% within 100 meters. The rest 8 to 9% do not have access within the 100 meters also. City sanitation ranking of 423 cities conducted by Ministry of Urban Development in 2011 found that none of them were healthy and clean. While only 4 cities fared relatively better, 190 cities were rated in the state of emergency. Open defecation in cities is reality for over 12.6% of urban households. Now, statistically, this may sound quite low, but 12.6% of urban households, you can understand, it's like 55 to 60% of the people, considering 4.5% average per household. So, what has been the conventional approach to water systems in India, particularly in the cities? Water has always been treated as a social public good, not a commercial one. And usually it has been underpriced, so the price do not relate to the cost of it. Then it has been primarily been driven by demand, and ever burgeoning demand, never been able to meet by the supply side efforts. To the extent that forget about the system losses, the government is more keen on generating additional sources of water. If you see the case of Delhi, we have 50% of the water is unaccounted for, which is technically termed as NRW, non-revenue water. But still, we are the Delhi government is fighting, and even the center has to pitch in for additional sources of water with the neighboring states. Then there is a question of vertical distribution of the subsystems. While water naturally happens to be a circular resource, within the urban governance, it has been managed within silos. So you have, conventionally, you have the Jal Board, you have a Sewerage Board. Now, according to the 74th Constitutional Amendment, all the activities, functions have to be devolved to the urban local bodies. In many instances, they have not been involved. In certain cases, the transmission is being taken care of by the state departments, while the corporations are taking care of the distribution itself. And then, when there's so much of multiplicity of organizations, you see that they're not talking to each other. Now, water in urban development schemes has been a subject since 1970s and 80s in the IDSMT program, the JNNURM program, BSUP, IHSDP, RAE, they were concerned about housing, distribution components. And now we are more looking into the smart cities, Amrut and Hriday. So this map shows us the selected 20 cities in the first round of the competition. And you see that, you know, a part of India has been covered, leaving aside the Gangetic Plains, cities in the Gangetic Plains. So what are the provisions for smart water in the smart cities mission? Adequate water supply is considered as one of the core elements. A pan-city development scheme could include wastewater recycling, smart metering, better management practices. Essential features of a smart city plan to have adequate water supply, recycling, stormwater reuse, rainwater harvesting, smart metering, improvement of water quality and increasing coverage. The O&M cost of water supply met by user charge collected has also been a scoring criteria during the selection of these cities. And non-revenue water is also a parameter for the mission outcomes. But just like, as they say, that Rome was not built in a day, so do our cities require meticulous application of some smart practices. Now, I would go through some case studies. I won't call them even a case study, they're like snapshots of some smart practices in water management in cities. The first and foremost, I'll start with the one that has been most comprehensive, which is the integrated water management in Singapore. Now, Singapore has traditionally faced the challenge of water scarcity and vulnerability since its independence in 1965. They've been buying water from Malaysia. There has been strong political and public will for water security. And the biggest challenge has been, you know, they've been losing water to the sea. So, the project aims to ensure efficient, adequate and sustainable supply of water for all in Singapore in order to deliver a healthy environment and support the economic activities at a high standard of living. So, they started off with creating a public utilities board way back in 1965, and with a series of measures, with meticulous planning, with an integrated approach towards water that includes water reuse and desalination of seawater. They've also gone for pollution control by this segregation. So the grey water and the black water are segregated. Then they also have a strong focus towards public education as an instrument to promote water conservation. And scientifically, when you say an integrated approach, what they have done with water is they've closed the water loop. So they have collected the grey water, they've separated it from the black water that you generate from the toilets. They have reclaimed it. Then the black water, they've started treating it. So this is how they've tried to close the loop. In addition, they've generated additional sources of water from desalination. So what they have is the four taps approach. The one tap, the first and the foremost that tap that they had at the city level was the water supplied from Malaysia. So they have generated additional taps, three additional taps from desalination, from reclamation of water, from treatment of water. Once they've segregated the water, the black water, they have built a deep tunnel sewer system, which basically conveys the wastewater to two centralized wastewater treatment facilities. Now, you know, land is premium in Singapore. And so what they've done is they've created two treatment plants at centralized places. So with the help of deep tunnels, they've diverted all the water to these locations, and then they've started treating it. Well, the first one that came up was Changi Water Reclamation Plant. It has a capacity of 800 MLD and one third of size in comparison to a conventional treatment plant. One of the major reasons behind it is they've already separated the grey water. Then the what they call is the dew water plant. That has also been introduced to further refine the reclaimed water by ultra-membrane process. Now looking at the demand side of it, they worked in three areas. One, the pricing. The pricing ought to be proportional to the costs incurred, both the establishment and the operation costs. The public education and other water conservation programs have been inbuilt. And what they call is the ABC of water. That is, whatever water exists in the public domain in terms of the streams, it has to be A, active, it has to be B, beautiful, it has to be C, clean. So they are able to not just clean water, but you know, it has to be visible also, it has to be interactive with the people also. So that is how they've been able to regenerate the public spaces. Now, key results have been, they've achieved 100% access to safe drinking water as well as basic sanitation. The Public Utilities Board have been quite instrumental in this. They've taken care of all the water-related activities as an umbrella organization. A resilient 24-hour supply that they have, the water losses have come down to 5%, which is one of the lowest in the world. The entire network is 100% metered. On the demand side of it, they've reduced, you know, the conservation measures involving the public, they've reduced it from 176 LPCDs to almost 153 LPCDs, and you know, they have a target of getting down to 140 LPCDs. Now, so it exemplifies one of the holistic approaches. The second snapshot that I'm going to show you is about the real-time management of large water supply network in Bangkok. Again, I'm citing all the Asian cases, which is a part of, you know, the conference deliberation. Now, the aim of the project was to address the problem of water loss by improved management of water distribution. Now, Bangkok provides water to 1.8 million customers. Their distribution network faced problems of water loss for damaged pipes, equipment, inaccurate meters. It said you can't manage what you can't measure. So the city installed controllers, pressure transmitters, magnetic flow meters, ultrasonic flow meters across 1,000 block stations all over the city. And so the real-time data poured in. They went one step ahead. They installed field control junctions that functions as intelligent remote terminal units. You could see over here on the pavements to control and, you know, time water flow remotely from the central control room. Next snapshot is about the water leakage prevention controls in Tokyo. Now, Tokyo, they started quite early from 1955 during the post-war reconstruction projects. They have over 26,000 kilometers of distribution pipes under the Tokyo metropolitan area. They are exposed to dangers of leakages, poor water flow, road collapse, inundation of building basements. So most leakages they've measured are caused by 97% being due to cracked or corroded pipes and 3% due to aging of distribution pipes. So the project aimed to make the best use of limited water resource by conducting prevention and early repair of water leakages from the distribution system. How did they do it? They used leak detectors, the electronic ones. Then after measurement and after detecting, they replaced the pipes from cast iron to ductile irons, from lead pipes to stainless steel pipes. So by now they've replaced 99% of their old systems. established a technical center to collect information on leaks, its causes, repairs they've executed, and then they're training it to the staff. They've started with a new approach, which is called the same-day repair approach. So the most advanced technology that they use are the helium, they use the helium gas to detect the leakages. And what are the results? As a result, they've reduced the leakages at city level to 2.7% from 20% during the 50s. The method of detecting and repairing leaks have halved, and as a result, the water wasted has reduced from 150 million meter cube to 68 million meter cubes. Now, they've also audited in terms of the CO2 reductions, in terms of the energy efficiency, saving 164 million kilowatt hours, the financial savings that they have made. Now, some of our homegrown experiments, one of the most recent being with that of World Bank's Water and Sanitation Program in Pimpri-Chinchwad. As you may know, when JNNERM came about and the center was funding the states and the urban local bodies, midway around 2008, they thought that, we're giving out the money, but we're not measuring it. So they came up with a concept of SLB, or a service level benchmark, to measure the service delivery indicators for water supply, sewerage, strong water drainage for cities against the benchmark norms. For example, your coverage of connection needs to be 100%. Your per capita water supply needs to be 135 liters per capita per day. Similarly, your coverage of toilets need to be 100%. Sewerage connected to a sewer line has to be 100%. So it was done by the urban local body. They later realized that there was an urgent need to bring in citizens' feedback. So it could not, it is not preferable to be done by an engineer Babu sitting in the office. That feedback loop has to be completed. So, World Bank, in association with the Ministry of Urban Development, launched the SLB Connect, a pilot program in Pimpri-Chinchwad, which, as you may know, happens to be one of the fastest growing urban areas, not just in Maharashtra, but also India. So, what was the features of this initiative? They conducted a mobile-based survey, real-time monitoring the survey using web-based management tools, and the analysis of survey results using online dashboard and data analysis tools. So that is how it was done, through MIS, through constant reporting, through mobile application of surveys, inciting responses from the common people across the different wards. Now, and this is, for instance, a display of the results that was obtained. Now, some of the greatest learnings from this. Number one, got first-hand opinion of people on a variety of parameters beyond the SLBs also. For instance, regularity of supply, adequacy, pressure, quality of water supply, and complaint redressal. Secondly, it corroborates data claimed by the local bodies in a more evidence-based fashion. And third, it gives a sub-city level data which could be further spatially transposed on a map for action. Now, last but not the least, is a snapshot of bulk metering with intelligent operating systems in Bangalore. So you may see Bangalore, one of the fastest growing regions in India, urban regions. Population escalated from 57 lakhs to 84 lakhs during the 10-year period 2001 to 2011. You see that non-revenue water, just like in large metropolitan towns, here also in Bangalore, it was 48% was unaccounted for. So nobody knows where does it go. It's all on account of leakages, on account of the bills not being accounted for. So there was an urgent need for bulk metering, system-wide monitoring. So they started this installation of bulk meters with a grant and a JNURM of 13.7 crores. Chetas Control Systems Private Limited was one of the organizations selected through competitive bidding, and they went for flow meters and installed them at critical locations before and after the service level reservoirs. And all the inlets and outlets were measured. The flow at particular time was transmitted through GSM network and transferred to the central server through the mobile tower located in the municipal board. So this is the basic architecture of this. The dashboard that displays the position from where it is being collected, the flow rate trends and the water consumption trends of not just 24 hours, you can have a fair look of all the 7 days. Now, what are the lessons learned from all these snapshot studies? Number one, there has to be a systems approach to water. Now, when I say systems approach, it has various dimensions to it. The first being that scientifically, you are able to close this resource loop. Number two, there has to be an umbrella institution delegating all water related responsibilities to the corporation, which had been mandated by the 74th Constitutional Amendment Act, would be the first step to moving towards this. And thirdly, which is the unwritten part of it, that there has to be more political autonomy given to these corporations. They should not be at the subsistence of or the subsidiarity of the state governments. Second, there has to be a holistic vision, but with more of a decentralized kind of an outlook when you're doing the management. Third, enhancing the municipal capacities. Now, we have the SLBs in place, we have the standard operating procedures, but there's a problem regarding manpower and financial capacities of these institutions. And as I said, most of it is going to come down when you're going to give them more autonomy. Then there has to be greater use of technology, when it is for metering, for MIS, for leak detections. Consumption has to be based on the user charges. Then, greater need of clean energy in both establishment and operation. As you may know, after salaries of employees, the highest expenditure that the ULB incurs is paying the energy bills. So one could always start with a regular energy audit. The next, water quality monitoring and maintenance. Greater emphasis has to go in also to ensure the quality of water. As we've seen, there have been experiments in ICT, greater use of ICT to deal with the metering problems. But all these efforts have to be scaled up, and if they are done in conjunction with using GIS for efficient management and decision making, that would work the trick. And then safety, disaster planning and resilience have to be internalized. They have to be brought into the entire planning of water rather than as an afterthought. And last but not the least, it requires a greater emphasis of towards public awareness, their participation. Now, however huge technological or engineering related investments are made, behavioral aspects could not be ignored. So, smart cities are all about smart people. So, I'd like to culminate this by offering a thought that let's think together that how you as an individual or a society could be smart while using water. And secondly, what actions you think are important but have a limited control over, for which we probably have to have a collective answer, have to think beyond individuals. Thank you.